This one says for animals. Like that they are animals, and animals are things. There are four things which are little on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their food in the summer. The rock badgers are a feeble folk, yet they make their homes in the cracks or in the rocks. The locusts have no king, yet they all advance in ranks. The spider, I think there's another translation that says the lizard, but the spider, both of them, they all fly, they all do good. But the spider skillfully grasps with his hands and is in king's palaces. Father, this morning, speak the words of divinity in this house. Even though we are instruments of righteousness, we submit to the fact that we are subject to the limitations of our humanity. That is why we ask for a fresh anointing, not yesterday's anointing, but a fresh and present anointing to exempt us from every limitation as we execute this assignment that you have given to us. I pray, Father, that not one man or woman, boy or girl, that hears the sound of the voice of your servant will leave you the same. We arrest confusion. We arrest distraction. We arrest the ability of the enemy to cause us to lose the train of thoughts of your preacher. And Father, we ask that the Holy Spirit will undertake for us. You are the teacher. You are the preacher. Wear me like a coat and use me to do good today. I pray in the name of the Lord that not my voice shall be heard, but the voice of Jehovah.
Amen.
We activate wisdom in this house. Activate wisdom in this house. Amen. Let the winds of wisdom blow over your people today. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Father, we thank you and we bless you. In the name of the Lord Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
For the past few days since Wednesday night, we've been dealing with this. This is a wisdom conference. And we came all the way for this wisdom conference. And I believe that is such a necessary conference or a necessary thing in the body of Christ today. What I have realized is that many times we give a lot of emphasis to some things which are very good, but we often overlook the small things which are amazing. And you have to understand that prayer and fasting alone cannot take you over. You can be very prayerful and still be a prayerful fool if you don't operate in wisdom. And I have said it, it has been said, our sister said it, pastor has said it, because I said it, that whenever wisdom is absent, pain is present. Bible says that he who walks with a fool will suffer trouble. And so you've got to understand that God wants you to walk in wisdom. It is wisdom that will cause you to outwit your competition. And we've been talking about wisdom from unexpected places. And what we establish is that as human beings, we try to look for answers in the big things that capture our attention. And we gave an example that people that go on safari to Africa, that there are the five big animals of Africa that everybody wants to see. We want to see the lion, we want to see the leopard, the buffalo, the elephant, and the rhino. And these are huge creatures. When they come around, they make the ground shake. Every photographer wants to photograph them for their magazines. National Geographic wants to do that. But God said that when I want to teach you wisdom, I'm not going to go to the big five. I want to show you through the small four. And so we got to talk about these things. And I realized that, you see, many times great things come in small packages. Great things in life come in small packages. Huge doors always swing on small hinges. No matter how huge the door is, the hinges that they swing on are very little. And I said that God told us in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27, that God has chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise, the weak things of this world to put to shame, the mighty, the insignificant things which are despised, God uses to make great statements. And on Wednesday, we looked at the ants. And all that the ant does is to prepare. We must prepare. Tell somebody, prepare.
Prepare.
Tell somebody, get ready.
Prepare.
Tell somebody else, get ready.
Prepare.
Listen, when preparation and opportunity meets, that is where success comes.
Amen.
A lot of people are working for breakthroughs, but they have not prepared. God has to prepare you for what he has prepared for you. That is why sometimes when I go through some things in life and we don't understand, you cannot always medicate your pain away. You can't always medicate the process. There are processes that that you have to go through. And hear me, ladies and gentlemen. If I took a 10-year-old girl and I put her here, and I put I took all the oil over there and poured the oil on the 10-year-old's head and laid hands and prayed and took authority and dominion and all the charismatic prayers, there's no amount of anointing that I carry that can take the 10-year-old girl to become a 21-year-old girl. She has to go through a process. So what is it about us that we want everything instant? Hear me, in your Bible, the only thing that grew overnight died overnight, and that is the tree of Jonah. But God has to grow you. You have to grow things. You have to grow through some things to come to that place. That is why you have to prepare. All the things that you are going through, ladies and gentlemen, is not wasted. All the things that God has allowed for you to go through is not a punishment. It is your preparation for tomorrow. Then on the second night, we came to the Rock Badger. Is it the Rock Badger?
Yes.
The Rock Badger does positioning. It positions itself. It is not strong. The Bible says it is feeble. No strong hands, no strong feet. It can't run, it can't fight. So what it does is that it positions itself in the rock. All of us must have a place where we are positioned, where the enemy cannot touch us. God said concerning Abraham and Moses that there's a place beside me, a rock on which you can stand. And so all of us must find some places to hide. And we establish that there's a season in your life that God wants to hide you. Many of us are madly in love with popularity, whilst God is madly in love with obscurity. You need to hide, and sometimes it is in your hiding that your greatness is found. If you want to be known, God will make sure you are known, and you know that you don't want to be known. There is a time for everything. Then, of course, on Friday, we looked at our old Mr. Locust. The locust can't fly, but the locust can jump into the wind, and the activity to the wind will help. Today we look at the last one, the spider. The spider. The Bible says that the spider skillfully crafts with his hands, and it is found in kings' palaces. Of the four creatures that we have been looking at, the only one that the Bible talks about where it ends up is the spider. It says the spider is little, remember, but it is found in kings' palaces. There's absolutely nowhere that you go today that you don't find a spider. From the White House to the Buckingham Palace to your homes, for some of you have overflow of spiders. Everywhere you will find a spider. And that is the amazing thing about this creature. And ladies and gentlemen, why is it that a lot of Christians are not found in kings' palaces? Think about it. Where are our Christian politicians? Where are the movers and shakers of this world? Why is it that we are so powerful in a church building, but we go out there into the world and nobody respects us? Why is it that we are so vocal, we are so strong, we are so committed and passionate within the four walls of a sanctuary, and yet we go to the corridors of power in politics and there are no true Christians? What is it about us that when we are looking for movers and shakers, we can't find them? But the Bible says that the spider is small and yet is skillfully grasped with his hands, and it is found in king's palaces. I have come to make an announcement and activate the force of wisdom over you, that from today, may you begin to make inroads into king's palaces. May you be found in Congress. May you be found in the Senate. May you be found in the corridors of business. Begin to resign from ordinary living and determine that you are never born ordinary. I don't care where you were born, it is where you are headed to that matters. I don't care what life may have done to you yesterday, but it is where God is taking you. Listen, refuse to die ordinary. You are not an ordinary person. God didn't give you permission to be born so that you occupy space on earth and die and go and occupy space underneath the earth. You were born for a reason and a purpose. That is why of all the funerals that you have attended, none of them is yours. It means heaven has a reason for you. You went through accidents and you are still here. You went through calamities and you are still here. They dragged you through the mud and you are still here. Look at the things that killed other people but has given you a testimony. You think God spared you because he had nothing to do? No, you were spared because there is a reason and a purpose for your life. Is somebody hearing me? And from today, I forbid you from thinking small about yourself. You are not ordinary. People may think you are ordinary, but you carry something on the inside of you. All the attacks that you have been through is as a result of the respect that hell has for you. The greater your attack, the greater respect that the enemy has for you. And so today, I want you to stand tall and look at the devil eye to eye and make an announcement that yesterday you made me to cry, but today I am lying.
marketplace. Listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. If you are working in Wall Street, you may be moving millions all about. But if you take your two-year-old child to the office, the child is not interested in the money you are moving from Hong Kong to Milan to London to Paris. No, they are interested in toys. And Jesus is saying that we are like children in the marketplace. People are moving millions in the marketplace, and we are behaving like children, and we are playing with toys. It is about time, ladies and gentlemen, that you begin to have a mentality that I am not ordinary. I am loaded with the Holy Spirit for a reason and purpose. I am a possibility with a capital P. I am a bundle with potential. I don't care how far I am behind in life. May divine speed come upon you. May the businesswomen arise. May the businessmen arise. May the movers and shakers of this generation arise. May the world begin to take notice of the church and know that God got you born again to win again. If that is your story, put your hands together and praise the Lord for some 5 seconds. A spider is found in great places. It is important to sit at the feet of the person who ends up in the palace. Is somebody hearing me? You see, the spider is amazing. The spider is the only creature of God who has its house in its body. It has its house in its body. Everything that he needs is in his body. Hear me. Your world is on the inside of you. I said your world is on the inside of you before you live in it. Your business is on the inside of you. Your future is on the inside of you. Your destiny is on the inside of you. Your destiny is not because of who you know or who you like or who doesn't like you. No, your greatness is locked up on the inside of you looking for expression. On the day that you were born, if you don't know, angels of God clap their hands in wonder because they have never seen anything like you before. There are 7.2 billion people on the earth today, and every day about 225,000 people are born and added to our population. But the amazing thing is that no two people have the same fingerprint. It means you are unique. There's nobody like you. You can go back as far back as possible into the annals of human history. You will never discover another you. So from today, stop looking down and lift up your head and understand that I am different. You may be different from me. Yes, you may be black, you may be white, you may be striped, you may be polka dot, you may be tall or short, but whatever it is, that God created you and there's nobody like you. You see, when something is mass produced, it is often not too expensive, but when something is custom made, it is very expensive. Let me make an announcement. You are custom made. One of a kind, one of a kind, one of a kind, and God will never create another you. So please learn to celebrate yourself, learn to love yourself, learn to like yourself, because that is what God Almighty made you. Ladies and gentlemen, the psalmist David looked up and he saw the wonders of the stellar bodies. He saw the sun, the moon, and the stars, and all of a sudden it dawned on him and he began to write by inspiration, and he said, "Oh Lord my God," Psalm 8, "how excellent is your name in all the earth. When I consider all the bodies that you have made, the sun, the moon, and the stars, and the beauty of your majesty," then suddenly he stops and says, "But what is man that you visit him, and the son of man that you so much love him? For you have made him a little lower than angels." That word angels in your Bible is the word Elohim. You see, the translators couldn't handle the thought that God has made you and I a little bit lower than God himself. Ladies and gentlemen, under God is you and I before angels. That is why we don't worship angels. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians, "Don't you know that one day you shall judge angels?" So angels are under our feet. They are our messengers and our watchmen. They watch over us and they execute judgment on behalf of the people of God. Let me tell you something. I don't care what your teacher told you because you have an F in a class. I don't care what your mother insulted you because she was insulted the father through you. I've come to make an announcement that you are not ordinary. You are a child of God. He said in Psalm 139, he said that he has made me wonderfully and fearfully made, and marvelous are your works, and my soul knows very well. So when you stand up, look into the mirror and begin to admire yourself, because this is who God made you. Oh, is somebody hearing me today? The time has come. Listen, refuse for people to come to call you all kinds of names because of what you have been through. You are not your experiences. You are not what the world has done to you. When people, sometimes you are filling forms and people are asking you what you are, then some of you finish the devil's sentences for him. You are drunkard. You are alcoholic. You are divorced. Who told you you are your experiences? Listen, you are separate from what has happened to you. know what I'm talking about. I remember once upon a time where you and I come from, there was hunger. And people used to kill. We used to call it what, essential commodities. Things like milk and those things. Thank you. You buy keke before you boil it. This one, he has suffered all this man. You buy keke. Look, some of you see, the reason why you behave like the way you behave is because you don't know what you have been saved from. And you are too forgetful. You are too. Listen, the antidote to pride is remembrance.
Amen.
When you remember where God has brought you from,
amen,
you can humble yourself.
Amen.
Some of you are too forgetful. You can't be so. The village you were born in doesn't appear on the most detailed map of your country. The whole post office box, the one we want to write to a letter, it takes months. So and so, care of Odikro, PO Box 1. The letter goes to the palace before they come and call you to come. Then meanwhile, you also need a letter writer to come and read, letter reader to read it for you. Today you are an American citizen, so you throw your weight about them. You come to church whenever you like. Humble yourself and remember that had it been for the mercy of God, where would you be today? You come about and brother, do you know who I am? Excuse me, who are you? What do I got? Don't you believe them? It is just by the mercies of God that you and I are here. Is somebody hearing me? Oh, one time, you know, whenever at your village or your town is quiet and you see people running towards a store, it means they've just gotten some essential commodities.
Yeah.
And there was a store underneath our house. There were some people queuing. And so the queue was amazing. They brought out milk and people were fighting over six things of milk. And one of the things of milk fell. The milk fell. And it rolled and it fell somewhere near a gutter. And somebody picked it up and said to the owner, oh, the thing was kind of squeezed a little bit. And said to the owner, oh, the thing is spoiled. The owner said, no, the thing is well, but the milk is still okay. I don't know about you, but life may have spoiled your outside. You may have been damaged. But what is on the inside of you is a treasure. For example, we have this treasure in every vessel. So hear me, I don't care what you went through. Yes, we know you went through divorce. Yes, you fell. You went through everything. But what is on the inside of you is perfect. Let it find expression. You are a spider, skillfully crafted with your hands and be found in king's palaces. Your world is on the inside of you. Thank you. Thank you. Hear me. Your greatest barrier is not anybody. Your greatest barrier is your inability to appreciate who you are.
Amen.
You are not what people think you are.
Yeah.
You are not what people assume. Please stop explaining yourself to people. Do you know why? Number one, because you are not on trial. You are not on trial. And you know the other reason? Your friends don't need explanations. You know the third reason? Your enemy will never believe you. So live your life.
Amen.
And be free.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? Listen, all the warfare that you go through is about what is on the inside of you.
Amen.
Your business, your ministry, your career, your dream, your millions of dollars, your destiny, your inventions. They are all on the inside. That is why, please hear me. From today, determine that you will not spend your life and your time on things that are not important. Have no time for time wasting. That is why you have to look around and look at your friends and begin to eliminate some of them. Not everybody is qualified to sit on the front row seat of your life. Listen, am I doing okay? Some of you are so emotionally and mentally bankrupt that you want everybody to like you. So you walk about and you parade a silly smile. Everybody can't be your friend. Are you hearing me? And you say, oh, Pastor, we belong to the same church. I agree. In fact, we go beyond the church. We belong to the same body of Christ. But we still are not friends. Hear me, as I stand here right now, my foot and my mouth, they all belong to the body of Osopia, but we have never met before. My mouth doesn't shake my foot. If I stop my foot, my mouth says, ouch. If I break my hand, my leg will go to work. But they are still are not friends. So the fact that I come to church with you, yes, we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. But if you are not taking me up, I am not staying down with you. I am selecting in who becomes my friend. The time has come for us to have some understanding. I'm not going to sit on WhatsApp and talk to you about things that don't matter. I'm not going to go on Facebook and what proves that it is me that you call? And what showed that I got your call? I did not get your call. Because, ladies and gentlemen, life is too short to waste.
Preach it.
Let me give you a couple of wisdom tips from the spider, then I'll begin to sit down. I didn't say I'm sitting down, so I'm beginning to sit down. So there's a difference between sitting down and beginning. Remember Peter, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1, finally my brethren, and he wrote two more chapters. So finally, brethren and sisters. The first wisdom tip about a spider is that the spider is productive. The spider is productive. If the spider wants to build a house, it produces it from its own inside. When it lays eggs, it brings protection for the eggs from its inside. The spider is a producer. The Bible says it skillfully grasps with its hands and is found in king's palaces. Please let me tell you something. I want to say it in morning day Columbus, Ohio English with my whole self. Let me say something. The 21st century church has become consumers rather than producers. And so today, the body of Christ in the church, there are three things that characterize the church. It is man-centered, performance-based, and need-oriented. So if my pastor doesn't come to church, then I'm not coming to church because God is absent. Man-centered. So we worship pastors. We worship prophets. Well, yes, we have to honor and respect them. But you've got to understand that their business is to coach you to do the things that God has called you to do. He gave us apostles, prophets, pastors, evangelists for the perfecting, for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry, which means you should, the pastor should coach you to do so. But today, we have made pastors gods, and pastors are working under pressure, and we are forcing them to do things they can't do. That is why we have a lot of liars called prophets. I wrote down here, you will say amen, and I don't care. This morning, I said 27,000 amens to myself, because I know I'll be preaching at the point and you'll be staring at me. That's fine. And I asked seven people from the studio and said, please stay at me before I go to church, so that when I go to church and they stare at me, I'm not being intimidated. So I thank God. But hear me, we become so need-oriented. Listen, you are always going to be in need. One way or the other, you are always, everybody is needy. That is why Jesus, in the believer's attitude, called the Beatitudes, he started by saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. All of us are poor one way or the other. You may be poor in money. Somebody may be poor socially. Somebody may be poor emotionally. All of us have poverty one way or the other. I've seen rich people who are very poor socially. They can't rest. So when they dress because they are rich, they overdress. Yeah. When you see them coming, they are like a Christmas tree. And you want to ask them, where are you going? Where are you going? Like the Yoruba one who said, kill on them. What is the matter? That's all I know that you're right. What is the matter? Oh, I've seen some before. Have blue shoes. No, don't look at anybody. No, don't look at them. Look at me. They have blue shoes, yellow pants, white belts, multicolored shirts, black and white jacket. You almost feel like you give them striped teeth, then it matches. But hear me, ladies and gentlemen, today we have become consumers. People shop around for church. We are all over the place looking for somebody to do our difficult job for us. Hear me, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for you to sit down and, like a spider, understand that there's something on the inside of you that you must bring it out. So from today, join the ranks of productive people. Amen. And not destructive people.
Amen.
The spider, have you realized that the spider never stops producing? If you knock down the spider web, you watch a spider, you knock down a spider web, it will rise up again and drop one little web and begin to spin another web. We can learn wisdom. So one thing that happened to you in 1947, you have stopped producing. And every day we meet you is the testimony of who did you wrong. Listen, life is passing you by. Everybody has had people do them wrong. But the educated man, the educated woman is the one who picks up the stones that people have thrown at you and use them to lay a foundation for your tomorrow. If you can be stopped, you will be stopped. If you can be denied, you will be denied. But if you can stand and look at your problem and say, you know what? You can do everything that you know to do, but you can never stop me. They tell us that it was Edmund Hillary that climbed Mount Everest for the first time. I don't believe it. But in exams, I write it so I can pass. Because if you listen, Africans, this is our problem. If you don't name your product, anybody will call it whatever they like. And so people have written, listen, until lions learn to tell their own story, their stories will always be told by hunters. It's wisdom 7. We are not telling our stories, so people are rewriting our history for us. Is somebody hearing me?
Yeah.
How do you see, you went to school in America and they ask you, who discovered America? You wrote Christopher Columbus and they gave you an A. Fine. But how do you discover a place that people are already there?
That's a lie.
When they came here, the Navajos were here, the Shawnee Indians were here, the Apaches were here, the Cheyenne, they were all here. And they said, I discovered it. And they named it after them. No. Columbus holiday, I'll take it and sleep, but I don't believe it.
That's a lie.
Edmund Hillary said that he was the first person to scale the Everest Mountain.
Yeah.
But it was not intensive. He was a shepherd. He was a shepherd. They carried load for the white people. And he got to the toughest before Hillary came. But he could write and the other guy couldn't write. So he said, I want to take a photograph of me. Who took a photograph of him when he was standing there?
Nobody.
I'm saying all this to say that Edmund Hillary tried many times so close. But there was a blizzard. And so he had to come down to Base Mountain. And he looked at Mount Everest and he said, Mountain,